Hey, everybody. How we doing? I'm Dan Harris. Today is a very cool opportunity to look at and really listen to these bugs and the sounds that they make when they're trying to attract a mate. It's also an opportunity to celebrate, if that's the right word, the once every 17-year emergence of these bugs, which are right now, as we speak, having a massive and very noisy sex party in our backyard. I learned a fun fact about these bugs. There are literally billions of males out there making most of the noise right now, and the odds for a male cicada, terrible. Here's the figure. For every female cicada, there are a million dudes. Which is how I felt for much of high school, as a matter of fact. 17 years is a long time. 1996, Bill Clinton was in the White House. So in order to sort of give us some historical grounding, the people at the festival have put together a little video. So before we bring on our experts, let's take a look at this video.
I doubt you'll remember us. We haven't been here for 17 years. Just 17 years ago,
President Clinton has won a second term.
I still believe in a place called hope.
Show me the money.
The whole system is breaking down.
Where's my truck?
Eric's mobile phone's surprisingly small.
I am not trying to seduce you.
Police say after he was finished, the robber ran through these double doors and then up through this parking lot.
Oh, that's so sweet.
Man. Thank you, Paula, for that. I appreciate it. I now have concrete evidence that I am aging. We're going to start. Our first participant is an environmental scientist who was the first to crack the code of the cicada's mating call. He also runs the most extensive periodical cicada tracking program in the country. Please welcome John Cooley. Can you assure my man here in the second row that the cicada will not hurt him?
Absolutely, it won't hurt you, and I'll show you a great trick to do with it later on.
All right. Our next participant is an author, philosopher, musician, and composer. His book, Why Birds Sing, was turned into a feature-length documentary by the BBC. His newest work, which is called Bug Music, a book and CD, features musical collaborations with insects. Please welcome David Rothenberg. Our next participant is a world-renowned expert on animal communication. He makes a living eavesdropping on insects to discover how signals are emitted, how they are processed by sensory systems, and how they have evolved. Please welcome Ron Hoy. And our final participant is the author of the very risque-sounding book, Sex on Six Legs. She's a professor at the University of Minnesota. Her research centers on sexual selection and the evolution of mating behavior in insects. Please welcome Marlene Zook. All right, so John, what I described it as a massive sex party, which I understand is not really the scientific term for what's happening out there. So what in real technical terms is happening outside right now with these bugs?
So what's happening right now with the cicadas that are out is they're finishing out their life cycles. They've spent 17 years growing up for this moment, and this is the moment when they reach adulthood and they have to go find a mate.
So 17 years underground, 6 weeks under the sun, and that's it. And yeah, they die. It.
Just a couple of weeks out as adults.
Do you think they're aware of and depressed about do they know this is the end, let's go out big?
Well, you know, that's kind of an interesting question. I would say people think, ask the question, what do they perceive? What is it like to come out from underground all of a sudden? Probably, actually, if they could think about it like we do, it would be horrifying. They've been underground where it's safe and nice and dark all this time, and now they're out with this hustle and bustle. It's a real difference.
Right, but they're, you know, one in a million of them is going to have a pretty good time.
Well, the odds are that, you know, the average male out in this emergence might not have that much luck.
Right.
But females are going to do pretty well.
So you've got this...
All works out in the end.
Yeah. You've got this citizen science tracking program. Can you tell us about what that is?
Yeah. Could you cue one of the maps? All right. So what we have to work with is we know something. We know a lot about the distributions of these cicadas. And this is a map of periodical cicada brood 2. These are the cicadas that are coming out right now.
Magicicada.
And this map shows that the cicadas are thought to come out from in a band from Georgia all the way up into upstate New York. Problem is that this map is made using old data. This map actually was made in the 19th century. And you can't go to any one spot on this map and predict what you might find there. And so the mapping project, the citizen science project, is an attempt to get you all involved in telling us where the cicadas are.
And where do the other broods live?
So can you cue the slide of all the broods? So periodical cicadas are actually found in eastern North America, east of the Great Plains, south of the Great Lakes, and a little bit up off the coastal plain. And so this is a map of all the periodical cicada broods. Last year was brood 1 down in the Shenandoah Valley. Next year is brood 3 out in Illinois and Iowa.
And different broods have different different periods of time under the ground, 17 or 13, as I understand.
Yes. Different broods are on different schedules, and there are also two life cycles involved. There are 13-year cicadas that are generally to the south.
What are they doing underground for that whole period of time?
Well, just feeding and growing larger.
Feeding on...
They're feeding on plant roots. They're specifically consuming xylem fluid. So think of it like maple syrup.
So they're not moving around at all?
We don't really know how much they move around. We presume they don't move very much.
And we have some video, I believe, of a cicada, and I think you were there for the filming of this, of a cicada emerging.
Right. So everyone is interested in what the life cycle of these cicadas is like. So we have a video right here. This is a cicada emerging from its hole in the ground. We call this stage a nymph, and also keep your eye on that little green insect down there to the left. I think Ron's going to tell us about that. So here's a nymph, and it's coming out of its hole, and it's a little walk. It's looking for a vertical surface. And so here it is. It's coming up to some good, safe place that it can latch onto.
And at some point, they change colors.
This is an insect, and so the skeleton is on the outside. And so every time they grow or change the form of their body, they have to shed the entire skeleton. And we call that process ecdysis, or molting. And that's what these nymphs all have to do. And that's what's going on in this slide right here. This is a time lapse of the adult emerging from the nymphal skin. And this adult, when it first has to pull all of its legs out, all of its parts out, very, very delicate process. It takes about an hour overall. And what you're left with is a pale white cicada that over the next half hour or so will darken to that black cicada with the red eyes.
And how do they know when to sort of come out en masse? What's the trigger?
So the cue seems to be soil temperature. They're monitoring the soil temperature from their holes, and when that temperature reaches about 64 degrees Fahrenheit, out they come.
But during the 17 years, there have to be several periods of time where it reaches 64.
So to pick the right spring, they're monitoring the annual cycles of their host plants. They're down there feeding on roots. The roots are of deciduous vegetation. Those trees, those plants they're feeding on go through annual cycles of growing leaves and losing them, and somehow the cicadas count that.
So let's bring in Ron Hoy here for a second, because Ron, there are, as John was pointing out, there are bugs that have a radically shorter life cycle.
Yes, and in fact, they're relatives of cicada. They're cicadas. They're called them. These are the plant hoppers, tree hoppers, they are the mayflies. And you saw that little green bug that you saw earlier. That is a picture of a mayfly. And if we could cue up the mayfly picture. So these insects only live for about a day or less. And so they complete their, so they don't bother having feeding mouth parts or a very reduced digestive system. They come out and they mate, find a mate. I think their odds are a little better than 1 million to 1. And they come out every single year.
So they spend a year underground and then they have 24 hours
in the water. Yeah. They're actually
in the water.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Back to the cicadas, does anybody know why 17 years?
That's really probably the number one question we get on the website. We have a lot of hypotheses for why 13 or 17 years, and every one of those hypotheses has something a little bit wrong with it. Many of them invoke predators, sort of standard ecological predator-prey cycle. If the cicadas have this long life cycle of prime numbers, the predators can't synchronize their lives to them. It sounds reasonable enough, but it's not exactly true. These cicadas do have a synchronized predator. It just happens to be a fungus. Other hypotheses invoke something about glaciation, and they sound reasonable enough as well, but lots of cicadas live in places that have been glaciated, and they don't have these odd life histories.
Isn't there an argument, too, that by coming out in such large numbers, they achieve what's called predator satiety?
Yeah, so these periodical cicadas come out in mass numbers, and that is their predator avoidance strategy. We call it predator satiation. And the individual risk to a cicada in this emergence is effectively zero. Other cicadas don't seem to do this. So this whole business of the periodicity, the mass numbers, and all that seems to be tied together.
And there was also something called Gauss's exclusion principle that may help explain this?
There are Japanese researchers, Jin Yoshimura, is working on some mathematical models that describe stability of life cycle phenotypes when they're able to hybridize and all that in complex spaces.
Anybody else have any thoughts on this whole 17, 13-year mystery?
Well, it's got to be important that they're prime numbers. It's very mysterious that it only happens in the eastern United States, nowhere else in the world. So you know, an explanation might have to do with something that only happens here and nowhere else in the world. And
sounds almost Kabbalistic.
It totally is, yeah.
I am a skeptic about doing cicada numerology.
Sex on seven legs?
Yeah, I know. The prime number thing only goes so far, remember? Yeah, they do have six legs, so.
Yeah.
Do you have any theories? Or you're just a skeptic?
No,
you're just
going to be a skeptic. I don't think we should
you
do
just
numerology.
My
I don't
life,
think we should do
way.
Numerology with cicadas, just saying.
It's a very fair statement, and you have to be very careful not to be seduced by the prime numbers because maybe also we don't know the life cycles of most cicadas, but maybe they're between 1 and 20 years for most cicadas.
Indeed.
And if you think about prime numbers, well, there's a very high density of prime numbers in the interval 1 to 20.
Absolutely. Right.
And no other interval in number space has that kind of a density of prime numbers. So they may be important, they may not. I don't know the answer to that one.
Other than the fungus, who are the main predator cicadas? Cicada predators, sorry.
Anything with a mouth.
Really?
Yeah.
Human beings?
Oh, yes.
They taste good?
I don't eat them myself.
But, I mean, you might not like chocolate ice cream, and that tastes good. So, I mean, are they edible?
Well, I'll tell you something. The Onondaga Nation that lives south of Syracuse, New York, the periodical cicadas are very important in the oral traditions of this Native American nation because the cicadas sustained the nation in times of famine. So there are cultural traditions in this country of people who eat the cicadas as a regular part of their diet.
But that's in this country. There are other countries where cicadas, not the 13 and 17-year variety, but those that come out every year, do in fact form a seasonal snack. And they're said to taste a little nutty. I don't know.
Do they eat the adult crunchy ones
yes.
or the nymph yes. juicy ones?
Well, you know, I only know about the crunchy ones because you can kind of put them on a spit and sort of barbecue. Nice.
You got to be pretty quick if you want to get a nymph, though.
Yeah. No, that's what people are supposed to eat in this species. They usually talk about you have to get the nymphs rather than the crunchy adults, wouldn't you say?
Nymphs are easy to find in these cicadas.
They're easier yep. than in other species.
Yep. Okay.
So there are a lot of predators, dogs, squirrels, whatever,
birds.
But what?
Birds.
Birds.
Birds are big predators, but and it's been noted that when birds have a strategy, they sort of gather around to the outside and then they fly in really quickly, grab one, and fly right back out. And the reason is that they are so loud, over 100 dB SPL, so loud that if they a grackle sat in the middle of a cicada chorus, it would get a headache really quick.
So do you think the sound is a deterrence to predators, is a defense mechanism?
No, because the birds keep coming. It's easy right. to, you know, they fly in, fly out, and they right. continue to go until they gorge.
I had read somewhere, clearly I'm not an authoritative source on this, but I'll just see if this is true, that the cicadas don't have many predatory defenses because they're so successful from an evolutionary standpoint. You know, they get billions of them, you don't really need to have some sort of bite or poison or whatever.
This is what works, and these cicadas are sitting fairly calmly in this cage. Other cicadas, like the dog day cicadas that you'll have out in July and August, wouldn't be doing that because those other cicadas do things to get away from predators. These simply don't. Hmm.
All right, let's talk about the noises they make. This is cicada serenades, after all. How do they make so much noise? What is the mechanism?
So let's cue up the photo of the tympanum. So all cicadas, have a special pair of structures on the first abdominal segment that we call timbals. There's a pair of muscles inside the abdomen that puts tension on the frame around these timbals, and that causes them to vibrate.
And that's the silvery...
And that's that silvery yeah. ridge structure right there in the center. And so let's play a cicada song. Can you cue up Magic Cicada Septendecim?
It's a great tune.
It's a good tune.
It's actually available on iTunes.
Here we go. And so this cicada is vibrating its timbals, and it makes that pure tone with a little down slur at the mm-hmm. end. Using the timbals to make that sound, the abdomen is a hollow resonator, and the sound radiates out through the openings in the bottom of the abdomen.
It's funny, when you hear one, it actually sounds quite different from hearing, you know, 100,000.
Yes, the sound of a whole chorus kind of mushes together and all the sound energy, you just hear these tones. But the individuals are all making that call that you heard right there in a septendecim chorus.
I think that's totally musically interesting, that one sound, the boo, you hear thousands of it, just hear, it's like the end dissolves and it becomes this vast drone all around you. You can't quite place it. It's sort of surrounding you with the trees.
So you like the sound of cicadas?
Absolutely. Don't you?
Yeah. Good question.
While you're thinking of an answer to that...
I'm not thinking about my answer. Yeah. I'm thinking about whether to give my
answer. Yeah, okay. Yeah. So Ron can demonstrate this maybe a little bit more clearly than seeing it on the insect.
So you saw that membranous frame with the ridges, which is thrown into folds. You can duplicate this slightly by this toy. And so this is a ridged popper. You can hear the individual pops. But in fact, what the cicada is doing is when that muscle contracts, you get a... So you can see that for each muscle contraction, you get a lot of sounds. And then...
You're getting a reaction, by the way.
That would be nice. Yeah. But anyway, that's the basic element. And so each of those ridges is sort of a clicking sound. So, you know, for dog training... It's basically biomechanically something just like that, only now you pile them up in series and you just pop that membrane back and forth.
Every time you make that click, I actually have this Pavlovian urge to stand on my
right.
hind leg. So how loud, you talked about this before, how loud are these bugs?
Well, 100 dB. Is almost industrial noise. It's like standing maybe a few feet away from a jackhammer.
Wow.
But these ones are not so loud.
No.
Other species of cicadas.
But that's collectively.
Collectively,
very close. The thing about a cicada chorus and what makes it horrendous is that you're never very far away from one. If you've got, you know, zillions and zillions of them singing in the trees nearby, you're never going to quite get away. And so that's why animals, even the most voracious predator, is not going to sit in the middle of a chorus. They duck in and duck out.
These are loud insects.
They
but
are.
These particular cicadas are by no means the loudest cicadas.
That's right.
The magic cicadas.
Yeah, they're relatively quiet cicadas as cicadas go.
But I mean, the sound of the same volume as a jackhammer.
That's one way of saying 100 dB. It depends on how far you are away from the object, but.
There's a genus of cicadas in Australia called Tofa, where the individuals are about 110 decibels. And so when they're calling together, it really is something else.
Wow.
Something you want to run away from.
Right.
So now we've been talking in terms of noise about the males, but you actually were, I think you did a big breakthrough study that found that the females are making sounds too. Can you walk us through how you made that discovery and how they're making noise?
Yeah, so one of the things that's interesting about the cicadas is for a long time we knew about the male sounds, and all that sound you hear out in the forest is the males. And we also knew that the cicadas have a number of different courtship sounds that they make, but we didn't know what triggers them to go through that whole courtship sequence and eventually end up mating with a female. And in 1995, my colleague David Marshall and I happened to discover that the females also make sounds. The catch is the females don't have these timbals or sound production organs. And so they make their sounds by flicking their wings. And it's a quiet little sound and a movement that they make with their wings. And it turns out to be the key that helps unlock what the cicadas are doing. And we're going to, in the grand tradition of demos on TV shows and panel discussions that don't work right, we're going to try it right here, and then in 30 seconds, we'll probably queue up a film if this doesn't work.
It's going to work.
It might work.
Yeah.
We have some live cicadas here, and this is a magic cicada cassini. So I'm imitating a courtship here.
You could all tell that, right?
Yeah. Right.
How does this work for you in a bar?
Not well. He's interested.
He is. He's moving.
He's moving towards me. So he thinks there's a courtship going on. He's going to try to muscle in on it here. And we'll see. It's a little cool in here. He's going to sit there like a lump. This is magic cicada cassini, and this is how they make sound. Let's cue the video and run through that.
That was nice. He was talking.
He wasn't talking to me. That's the noise they make when you pick them up, and they'd rather you drop them. So here's a male calling. This is a nice video right here of a male calling. And this is septendecim. It's another species from the one I had in my hand. And he's going to call and fly. So he'll go to a perch and make a couple of calls and then fly to another perch. And that's what's going on up in the trees. And he didn't get a response from anybody, so he's going to fly away and try somewhere else. So he's calling, walking around, a couple of calls. And here comes a female. So this cicada right here is a female. She's flicking her wings in time to his call. Now watch her. That's her signal. And now, boy, he's interested in that. So he's begun a court two call. Watch that leg. He's going to vibrate her leg. And now he's begun court three call. He's touching her, and he's going to climb on and mate.
We're going to show that?
I think so. So she's arching her back. This is absolute acceptance by this female cicada. She has flicked her wings, and she's arching her back. He's touching her, making the court three call. She's moving a little bit. She's got to get a good place so they don't get knocked off. And here we go.
Cover your eyes, children.
Right. All right. So that wing flick signal turns out to be the key to the whole thing. And if we have cicadas that are warmed up and cooperating, you can imitate that. What you have here is a male that's coming in and trying to move in on a courtship. So this male is flapping his wings. He was about to get a mating, and this third cicada has come up here to disturb the whole thing, and he actually gets the mating. So there's a lot of that going on. A lot of male-male competition and a lot of kind of muscling aside and replacing.
It's a cold world.
So that's the whole mating sequence right there. And the trick that you can do with the cicadas and the males is if you learn that timing, you can go out there and just a little click like that, you can get the cicada to run through all those different signals.
Is that all you can get the cicada to do?
That's about it. There's not a big behavioral repertoire there.
So, Ron, how are they? What's the mechanism through which they're hearing and interpreting these signals? And given how loud it is, how do they not have their senses overwhelmed?
So, just behind the timbal organ is another very thin membrane called the eardrum, the tympanum, and that's how they hear the sound. So, sound travels through the air and causes the eardrum to vibrate, just as in our ears. Now, when a male cicada is singing, what he does is relax or loosen up the muscles around his own eardrum so that he doesn't deafen himself. Many insects actually have this problem, so that you don't want to deafen yourself, and so you tune down your own hearing. And a cicada does this through muscular action to essentially loosen up the membrane so that it can't, so that it's no longer taut to be, it's no longer tight like a drum head, so that a sound playing against it is not going to cause it to be excited. Because the nerves which service the ear of this teardrum of the cicada are attached to the eardrum.
And Marlene and John walked us through in a lot of detail the actual mating process there. But in terms of the noises they're making to one another, can you translate it all? What are they saying?
Well, the males are saying that they're available and would be interested in having a female come up. I think that's pretty much the size of it. One of the interesting things about cicadas is that unlike some singing insects, the males don't have, there's not a lot of variability. Like there's not a lot of, oh, this one sounds really good, that one sounds really bad, that one's going to be one that all the females are going to want to go to, that one's going to be a dud, and so forth. And so one of the big mysteries is the odds may be 1,000,000 to 1, although that might be slightly exaggerated. But the odds may be really against an individual male, but it's pretty mysterious why that one male gets lucky, because it certainly doesn't seem to be something about his individual song.
So the female can't evaluate the strength of his signal?
Not in cicadas. In a lot of other mm-hmm. insects, they do. But in cicadas, they, you know, and people like John and others have looked and looked and looked, and there doesn't seem to be anything about an individual male song that makes him more or less attractive to the female.
Just luck and timing.
Yep. It's a lot of it.
Location, location, location.
Yeah.
How do you think they developed these signals? I mean, from an evolutionary standpoint, what do you think fed into the types of noises they developed and how they're interpreted? Is there anything going on there?
Yeah, I mean, presumably there was some kind of primitive, you know, vibrating membrane, but from there, not clear.
Well, actually, the Hemiptera, this is the family tree. So cicadas are one branch of the Hemiptera, and they have this elaborate timbal, which enables them to produce these very loud sounds. But other members of that family tree, like the tree hoppers, plant hoppers, also make sounds. They also have a timbal. And if we could cue up one of the tree hopper or plant hopper videos, that would be great. But now, these animals are about 10 times as small as a cicada. And from their name, plant hopper, tree hopper, and I'm sure you've seen them from time to time, they also produce sounds, and for the same reason. So here's one, and let's watch the abdomen. Hear that? Can you hear that little coo?
It's really soft.
It's a coo. It sounds like yeah. These bugs actually are called thorn bugs. I mean, they're there. Now, see the abdomen move? It's.
What kind of microphone picks that up?
Okay, so.
Laser vibrometer.
Yeah, he used a laser vibrometer, but you can use, back in the day, there were things called phonographs and cartridges and needles. If you put the needle right down on the plant, you'll pick it up.
Even.
Yeah, right.
Even just a long tube listening.
That's right. Listening. So you can't hear that sound, but they can because it's actually transmitted through the plant. So they're feeling it with their legs.
So we want to talk more about those bugs later, but first let's listen to a little music. Can you just walk us through how you got interested in making music with bugs and how many accusations of insanity did you have to fend off in the process?
This is the first one. it's all fine and well to say, all these sounds are just advertising. Here I am, it's mating time, you know. But the message is the same throughout the natural world. The difference is in the music. Every species has its own... those that make these sounds has its own musical way of getting this message across. And it's the differences in how they do it that are an incredibly fascinating part of the natural world. And I've found that when you take these mating behaviors, these sounds and their responses, and the actually amazingly complex musical ritual of cicadas, it's incredible that John Cooley figured this out. We should give him a big hand.
And David.
John Cooley and David Marshall. And... So I found as a musician interested in being influenced by natural sound, you know, when you really pay attention to these sounds and listen to them, sure, it all sounds at first menacing, like noise. But when you attend to it, when you learn that there's actually each of the three species has like three different sounds, up to nine different sounds are going on at any one time. It's like a whole orchestra. And you're just going to find your way into it. And the fact that every individual is just a small part of it. So if you want to play along with that, you're just jumping in with the millions. And so I found in these different animals I've worked on making music with, it's all like a long learning experience to expand the boundaries of what music is. And I'm going to play one piece together with my friend John Wizorek, percussionist here. First piece will be based on these cicada sounds, and the second one will be based on treehopper sounds. They're going to be really loud.
Good.
We're going to be jacking awesome. Them up. You know?
Go for it. This is very cool, and by the way, I don't think it's insane at all.
I'm glad. On my side.
I'm on your side. Yeah. This is from his latest CD, Bug Music, by the way. The first song, the second song was made just for us.
It's also on Bug Music.
Leave it there. I want to take a picture.
They're harmless. I promise. It's gonna be inspired.
Got it. Live tweeting.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Now the buffalo tree hopper really does make one of the wildest sounds of any insect.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks. Do you guys do bar mitzvahs?
Absolutely. 13 years. 17 years.
Right. Bug bar mitzvahs. Thank you, David and John. Nice job. We'll hear more from them.
Great.
So, another question for the group. Cicadas, now that we're in the middle of this mass invasion, what kind of damage, if any, do they do to the environment? Are they destroying these trees?
No. No. So, one of the things, a lot of cicada myths out there that we like to dispel. Our job here is to help educate people about what these cicadas are and what they're doing. Now, early on, the colonists, North American, European colonists, thought they were a biblical plague and called them locusts. And from that point on, this kind of aura of something sinister or damaging has followed them around. But the reality is that unless you're an orchard grower, and you know, orchard trees, or unless you're growing trees for a nursery, you really have nothing to worry about with these cicadas. Now, they can damage nurseries, they can damage orchards, but beyond that, they're not a pest, they're not destructive.
And from what you know of brood 2 at this point, does it seem like a robust crop?
It seems par for the course. I would say there are some populations that seem like they might be waning, they might be in trouble. It's not sure, and we're not sure. One of the things we face as biologists is this problem. You go into some place and you find a low-density population. Is it a population that's getting established and growing, or is it a population that's on its way out and facing extinction? Now, in this case, you're going to have to check back in 17 years.
So can there can be real variations from 17 year to 17 year?
So certainly there are two broods that have gone extinct in recorded time, and there's one brood in upstate New York that's probably on that route as well.
And what's the major threat? What drives this extinction?
Well, there are really two kinds of things that are driving that. One of them is what people do. If you cut down the trees, if you develop the land into something else, cicadas aren't going to do that well. But there are also long-term patterns in climate change, just the natural fluctuation and rainfall and temperature that we have here in North America associated with glacial cycles.
So is there a specific reason why we should really care about the health of the cicadas overall, other than it's nice to have them, kind of?
Well, these cicadas are moving a lot of nutrients around in their ecosystem, so it's a resource pulse for the birds and other animals that are out eating them, and they're also moving nitrogen and phosphorus, two of the limiting nutrients for a lot of animals and plants. They're moving those substances from below ground pools to above ground pools, and that's a really important ecosystem function.
What about, do they serve at all as a sort of canary in the coal mine for climate change?
There's an element of that as well. Certainly, the periodical cicadas require healthy, intact forests that are not too fragmented. And if you don't have that, you're not going to have periodical cicadas.
Anybody else have any thoughts on sort of why we should care about the health?
Well, I think in general, in nature, the extremes are often the best examples, the most interesting things in nature. Cicadas with this crazy, mysterious life cycle, peacocks with huge, beautiful tails, mockingbirds with long songs, humpback whales singing, and human beings with our strange brains and our need to totally manipulate the environment. These are some of the most interesting species in the natural world, and the very fact that evolution allows these weird things to sometimes happen, not most of the time, but sometimes, means that the possibility for extreme madness and interest is always there. Sometimes it gets through.
John, I was wondering whether or not Brood 2 once sang in Central Park.
That's kind of the question of the hour. If you look at a place in Manhattan, likely a spot for periodical cicadas in Manhattan, well, it would be Central Park. Are there cicadas there now? I'd be shocked, really. It's too small a patch. It's too manipulated. Now, Central Park is a completely artificial environment. It was created by landscape architects. And so I'd be shocked, really, if there were periodical cicadas. I'd be pleased, but I'd be surprised.
But from the time it was laid down, yeah, there have never been cicadas there.
Well, historically, before humans built New York into what it is today, yeah, and what we all know and love, There almost certainly would have been periodical cicadas in that area, and historically there are records of periodical cicadas from this very spot right here in the Botanic Gardens. Again, we don't hear the big choruses of cicadas out in the Bronx Zoo or the Botanic Gardens. And it's probably because these landscapes are too manipulated. They're too artificial for the cicadas to persist.
But they love golf courses.
Well, certain golf courses, but golf courses that are backing up on woods that haven't been modified in that same way.
Before, I want to turn to some other insects. Before we do so, any closing thoughts on the cicadas?
Well, I would say about the cicadas, a reaction of being appalled by them at first, it's perfectly natural. But this is a great opportunity to get out there and watch some insects in the wild and see what they do and appreciate nature and understand, hey, things, really complex things are going on in your own backyard, and all of this drama, all of the spectacles happening with these funny little insects that are up in the trees making this sound.
You can think of the haiku poet Basho in Japan writing of non-periodic Japanese cicadas. He said, "Cicadas sing, know not how soon they all will die."
Any other closing thoughts on the cicadas before we move? It's hard to top that.
Yeah, right.
It is.
Basho is a great closer.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, he could be talking about us.
Yeah.
Crickets.
Okay, so crickets are the other, and more regularly, acoustically or conspicuous singing insect in our environment. You know, in October, you can't get them out of your garage. But they make a very pleasant sound. Now, they produce sounds by a very different mechanism, whereas cicadas and leafhoppers have timbals and this special mechanism. Crickets use a much more simple one. They rub their wings together. It's grasshoppers that rub their... In fact, grasshoppers don't rub their legs together, as some people think. They're rubbing their legs against their wings. But crickets rub their wings together, and so one wing contains a file, the other wing contains a scraper, and so it's like rubbing your thumbnail against a comb. And that's how they're doing it. Do you have can we cue up a cricket song?
We had one before, so.
Yeah.
And the noises they're making are courtship noises.
Yes, they are. They have several repertoires. So there's the calling song, which presumably is analogous to the cicada song. And then that's for long distance. But only the males, just as in cicadas, only male crickets and katydids sing. The females are attracted and drawn to. They home in on the song. So the calling song is different. It tends to be brr, 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 or in tree crickets, brr. It's a steady tone, and females use that as a homing beacon. So they come in on that. And then once they're within contact, at least in field crickets, you move over to a different song. Cicadas also had stage 2 and 3 courtship songs. In crickets, the field crickets around here, and there are plenty of them in Central Park, they move from a chirp, chirp to a... And sometimes you'll hear that in your garden. And if you hear a brr, that is the sound of a male who is actually touching and the rubbing antennae with the female. So that's the pre-courtship ritual. And at that point, the female can either accept or reject him. And Marlene has a lot to say about rejection.
That was phrased
right.
Oddly.
Yeah, that's right. Okay. About selection. Sure. Choice.
So crickets are certainly the more familiar singing insects that everybody hears. And like Ron said, they're the ones that... the males make their sounds by rubbing their wings together. But so unlike, there's a few ways they're different from cicadas. First of all, they don't have these big bursts of emergence like the cicadas do. So we hear them all the time and can take them for granted. But also they're calling at night. So the cicadas are making their sounds during the day, but the crickets are mostly calling at night. Most of the katydids are too. And they're calling kind of under cover of darkness, and the females are attracted and come over to mate with the male. And there, the crickets do have differences, so some males have better songs than others, and I and lots of other scientists have spent time trying to figure out what makes a particularly good cricket sound.
What have you learned?
Well, so there isn't sort of one, it gets sort of technical. So usually crickets that put a lot of energy into their sound are the ones that the females tend to prefer, but the females always have the ultimate say.
So they're not like into subtlety.
Well, you know, I suppose from a cricket's perspective, you could call it subtle. Like, I don't know. Yeah. We could argue. But anyway, the point being that from one of the cool things about sound production and mating in crickets is that the female's kind of in charge of the show. You both in cicadas and in crickets, you tend to pay attention to the males because they're the ones that are making all the noise. But it really, from an evolutionary perspective, the only thing that matters is what the females do, because she's the one that is going to either mate with a male or not. And if she doesn't mate with a male, then he's not passing his genes on. And if he's not passing his genes on into the next generation, then it's just a loss from an evolutionary perspective. And it really doesn't, you know, his life really has no meaning. If we're gonna, you know, if we're going into this sort of apocalyptic,
sing, fly, mate, die.
Yeah, right. Well, you know, it's
right there.
It's so existential.
Yeah. Now, one of the issues that I've read in my handy research packet compiled by the same people who found a video of me from 1996. So I don't know if
you're still not recovered from that, are you?
Yeah. No. That and you pointing out that my life has no meaning.
Yeah.
Now, my point out that your life has no meaning was making a lot of presumptions about your personal situation, which I would not dream to do.
It's not that interesting, but we could hold a separate seminar on it later.
Yeah. It's complicated.
Anyway,
it's complicated.
That's actually not complicated.
Do we want to cut to another demo of what cricket song? Ron has other things he can show you.
But I wanted to ask you a question that apparently when they're making this noise, one of the risks is they can attract predators in the process.
Yeah, so the big thing, and you know, David was talking about this too, so you have peacocks with great big elaborate tails, you have all kinds of animals with bright colors and loud songs and lots of things they use to attract the attention of somebody else. And so the intended somebody else is a member of the opposite sex, but it's really a risk that you can attract the attention of somebody you were not intending to attract, namely a predator or a parasite. And there's lots of specialists on the songs of insects. There's predators that will be attracted to brightly colored birds and so forth. And so it makes you really appreciate how hard life is for a lot of these singing male insects, because anytime they start producing a song that makes them attractive to bringing a female over, which remember is the only thing that will lend his life meaning, and I really was talking about crickets, it's the only thing that will lend his life meaning, but at the same time he's going to risk attracting maybe a parasitic fly, which is some of the predators that Ron and I have both worked on, that are going to come over and attack the cricket and make sure that it dies before it has a chance to leave its genes to the next generation. So it's a very delicate balance, that the more you call, the more likely you are to attract a mate, but the more you call, the more likely you are to attract one of these predators. And so evolution's produced this sort of opposition in every cricket song you hear.
That's actually a cool way to think about it. And when John was showing us a video earlier of the cicadas, and there was the cicada was about to like get, you know, lucky with a female cicada, and then a third guy comes in. Is that happening with the crickets too?
It does. Because anytime you produce a conspicuous signal, then that signal can be read by unintended recipients.
And that can include other male crickets. So sometimes you might have a single male cricket singing his heart out, chirping away, and here comes the female. And then there can be another cricket of the same species, sort of a little downwind, so to speak, who will intercept that female without singing at all. And that's called a parasitic male. And so that's
sometimes
another
they're called satellites, which is a little more benign term. You know, calling them
poachers.
Parasitic seems a little
poachers.
Over the
poachers.
Yes, right. Yeah.
Whenever you think about these signals in insects, and this goes for the cicadas as well, for the intended recipient, the signal is there's a mate right here.
Right.
But for other members of the same species, it's also, hey, there's a receptive cicada over here. And for other species, it could be something as simple as, hey, there's a piece of food over here making noise. And so you have to think about that when you look at the behavior of these insects. And it certainly shapes the behaviors of cicadas as well. Most other cicadas, except the periodicals, are subject to all these same problems.
Let me put in a plug for the parasitic fly that that Marlene was talking about.
This is going to be a hard sell.
Right. No, it's no, not really. It's not really. Okay. They're utterly cool.
Yeah.
Wait till you hear.
Okay.
So once you put a song out there, it's out there, and it can be for a female of your own species or a parasitic fly, and so my lab and an engineer named Ron Miles has been studying the ear of these parasitic flies, and the amazing thing is that they have evolutionarily invented a third kind of ear. These flies are really small, so they're the size of a house fly or smaller, and so their ears are even going to be smaller. This third kind of ear was heretofore unknown by the bioacoustics people, and so my colleague in Binghamton is basing an in silicon now making a microphone based on this fly's ear. And it promises to be a very important design for the next generation of hearing aids.
Wow. So I take it all back.
because thinking about what crickets have to do, it's a really big problem, right? You have to localize where a really tiny thing is producing a song from way far away. Mm-hmm. So how do you localize a song or a sound at all? I mean, when we do it, you compare what's coming into both of your ears, right? And if you turn your head, you can localize a sound better. Well, if your ears are really, really, really close together, then it becomes hard to compare the sound that's coming in. And yet, these flies that, like Ron says, are the size of a house fly or even smaller, can find the song of a male cricket calling from, you know, hundreds of feet away with deadly accuracy. They're better at finding a calling male cricket than a female cricket is. So how do they do that? And part of finding out the answer to that has been a discovery that we think is going to lead to better hearing aids and, you know, better microphones and better ways to understand how sounds are produced and received. So a lot of this stuff, you know, people are always asking about, you know, when people ask me what I do research on, and if I really want to give them the short version, I say, oh, I do research on bug sex, which is true, and that is what I work on is bug sex. But you never know what kinds of information are going to come out of studying these extremely basic processes in what animals do.
Yeah, sometimes these unintended consequences are amazing. And so there's a whole field of engineering called biomimicry, where engineers go out and look at how small animals, big animals, solve the same sorts of problems that we need to, but they've had millions, you know, hundreds of millions of years of evolution to perfect them. And so by working these out and then implementing them in silicon or whatever technology that you have, basic research ultimately pays off, even though there may not be that target in the beginning. I mean, when people like Marlene and I were studying insect hearing, hearing aids were not on the radar at all. I mean, but it just turns out it's got a different kind of ear, and it's really small. And then an engineer working with us said, that's cool. I can make it in silicon. And so from that has really come a technology.
It's very cool. I agree. And David, you have a song with grasshoppers. Crickets, rather.
Yeah, I think general people like the sounds of crickets. In China, people have collected them for hundreds of years just to listen to them, put them in little boxes, carry them around as pets to hear their song.
And for fighting.
And they also like to fight them against each other.
And fighting, yes.
In fact, they've had a whole, like, some of these crickets were worth thousands of dollars.
Really?
If they're really good fighters, or perhaps really good singers. And I talked to some people into this, saying there's like a division among people who buy them in Chinese cricket shops, either to fight them or to listen to them. Like, there's a whole argument as to what this is really for.
I'm on the listening side of that fight.
Yeah. We're going to listen to some now.
Awesome.
You guys stay there.
Yeah.
That's real.
Thanks. David, as you sit down, I want to do a quick lightning round. We're almost out of time, but we've got a few other species we want to talk about. Ron and Marlene, mosquitoes actually make some songs other than the annoying ones that they do right in our, like, right in our ear.
Actually, they make the same, they do. So what we have here is a picture of a male mosquito. He's just come out and he's chasing.
Is this an animation
female.
Or a real?
No, this is real. It was taken at 5,000 frames a second. You've probably never seen a mosquito like this. But at any rate, that's the chase. In fact, the sound that you hear so annoyingly buzzing around you, that's also the mating in context and at time. That is the mating call. Now,
but they're not trying to mate with us at that point, though.
Well, hopefully not. Now, in fact, it's only females that go after us, and that's after they've mated. And the reason why they want us is to get a good protein meal to nourish the eggs. It's female mosquitoes that do the biting, males don't bite. But the mating ritual involves sound. Female mosquitoes are a lot bigger than male mosquitoes, by and large. So they're both in the air. All of this happens in the air. This is sex without a net. So they're flying around, and what happens is that the male, first of all, male mosquitoes form a huge swarms. You've sometimes seen these swarms in the tropics, and the females will come flying in. So there, a single female comes flying in with gazillions of males, singing, and what she does is she will adjust her wing tone and expects the male to match. And if he doesn't do it quickly, she simply goes on. And in fact, she is essentially interviewing or auditioning different males. She's a lot bigger and she can decide. So it's very simple for a female to reject just by kicking away. Or by extending her legs, and a male can't come anywhere near. So a male has to be able to match her song, match his call. So it's anything you can do, I can do better, sort of thing. And so that's an extreme example of female choice again. And Marlene probably has
and
many
so
other.
You know, again, the females are pretty much in charge of the whole process that goes on.
Right.
I like this. So jumping spiders.
Okay, jumping spiders are among the most amazing creatures on eight legs, and maybe even six. So they make very elaborate. And listen to the sound. So this is the human counterpart. So jumping spiders make sounds, and their sounds are as complex as the cicada sounds, just to have some closure. But it just shows you that sound underlies mating behaviors of animals, not just frogs, birds, quails, humans.
And katydids.
Katydids are a lot like crickets.
Say that again?
They're a lot like crickets. I mean, they're just green, big green crickets. And so they don't have nice pure songs, but they do it in pure tone songs. They're noisier sounds, so ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch.
Just like the jumping spiders can produce songs that are either too quiet for us to be able to hear or are done at a frequency that we can't hear either. And so one of the things that I hope everybody takes away from them is that all of a sudden the world should feel really filled with sound for you. That even if it's sound that you can't quite hear, you should know that it's going on all around you. And during the day, it might be cicadas or maybe a tree hopper that is pushing its abdomen against a stem. And during the night, it might be katydids or crickets. But all the time, the world is filled with sound. And there are all these animals doing things all around you. So hopefully you won't hear the world the same way anymore.
Yeah, I hope you'll be inspired the way David was inspired by their sounds. I mean, they are amazingly complex. They're sometimes hauntingly beautiful. And isn't it wonderful that they can inspire human creation in our music?
Yeah.
And when we're walking around engrossed in our own little dramas, maybe we can think about the huge pageant going on right within our eardrop.
Yeah, right. There's a lot of dramatic stuff happening.
Which actually leads me into, and you may have answered it, but I would love to hear from the two of you, John and David, as a final thought, why is it worth studying these animals with the intensity with which you bring to the game?
Well, I think if you understand a little bit more about the world around you and what's going on around you, maybe it helps you understand a little bit more about yourself and your role in the environment.
Well, I think that, you know, this whole session today has shown that when John hears the sounds of the singing cicadas, he's hearing one thing, and I'm hearing something else, because he's coming at it as someone who studied them for years and tried to figure out, to decode this behavior. And I'm hearing it as the glimmers of music, as part of this whole musical composition. And music is one human way of knowing the world. Science is another. And neither reduces to the other. And to be a human, a person who tries to know the most about the world, you have to use all the techniques we have to make sense of nature. And the connection of science to music and to art and poetry is one, when faced with the same phenomenon, is one example of how we need all these things. That's what's great about being a human. You have so many ways of confronting the world, and different answers come out.
You four have really opened our ears and our minds today. I know, David, you're going to play us off. What's your last song?
Well, I kind of changed my mind about what to do since we've had all these sounds coming from machines and things. I think we're just going to play my percussionist, John Wisorek, and I, we're going to play just together a duet, improvised, based on this idea that the sounds of insects can inspire music. That what might have began as scratchy noise and ratchety buzzes is all part of this rhythm, these irregular, sometimes regular rhythms of nature that we can tap into when we want to. And if you want to play some katydid type sounds, because you have a lot of percussion instruments here, Ron, I really wish you would join us with your insectivorous practice approach.
Okay. Yeah, insectivorous means he's eating.
Well, right. Nobody's eating. Yeah. Entomological wizardry.
There you go.
Here.
Sure.
Whoops. I'm joining with Giro. So you can just rub it against there.
Thank you. Thanks a lot.
Our thank you to the New York Botanical Garden. We also want to remind you that as the magic cicada emerge, you can track them through John Cooley's Citizen Science Cicada Tracking Program. And if you want to find out how to do that, you can visit worldsciencefestival.com. See you later.